Let me share my screen. And there we go. It's recording, right? Okay, let me just pull up the chat and then we'll start. Okay, thanks. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the first lecture after the exam. How was everyone's exam? Was it good? Good. Yeah, I see some thumbs up. There's some good news. I think we have the highest average scores of all times, which is like out of the last 10 semesters I've taught this course, you guys have performed like phenomenally well. Although we did not reduce the toughness of the exam or the rigor of the exam, but you all did like phenomenally well, which is like, I think it's like great. Probably I don't know like whether we scared you when you saw the quiz scores, but you did really well on the exam, which is great. Yeah, that's good. So today, on the auto-graded questions, which is like, I think the average was roughly about 84 or 83, something like that, kind of very high compared to previous exam ones. So that's excellent. And today we are going to just complete sorting, which is, I think we did not finish quicksort last time. So I'll just go over the pseudocode for quicksort. And then we'll get started with sets, maps, and hash tables, which also is a crucial component of your project too. I think after Thursday's lecture, you'll have all the knowledge that you require for project two. So we'll start discussing that as well. And I'll try to complete the first half of 2A today, and we'll cover the second half of 2A, which is like the unordered map on Thursday. That's the goal. Any questions before we move forward on any course logistics? We have moved the project two date by, I think, like 4 or 5 days, because we wanted you to have at least like 2 weeks from Thursday to finish that project, which is like more than ample time, okay? So just a quick recap, we covered merge sort. I actually did not had previously slides on visualizations. So I've worked on them, but I'm not going to cover these slides. You can like look at them if you do not understand the recursion stack, okay? These are uploaded on Canvas. I think I covered that and gave you a walkthrough on how the recursive calls were behaving. But if you need a neater set of slides, just use these ones. They explain to you how the recursive call stacks are working, okay? I'll keep moving forward because we have already covered merge sort. I don't want to spend more time on this. We'll go straight away to quicksort, which is, we discussed the fact that quicksort is a sorting algorithm that essentially allows you to partition an array around a pivot, and at every iteration or at every pass of a quicksort, all the elements towards the left of the pivot are smaller and all elements on the right of the pivot are greater than the pivot. That's how essentially the algorithm works. I think I went through the entire pseudocode, so I just want to go over the code and show you how this works, which is essentially the code is pretty similar to merge sort, especially the calling code or the code which takes care of all the recursive calls. There's one code difference that in the merge sort, we did not had our partition function returning a pivot. It was just breaking the array into smaller chunks, but we did not had basically a partition function that returned a value. So in this one, actually, it returns, the partition function actually returns whatever is the pivot at every iteration or every pass. So let's say if we have this array, which is like, I'll draw this really quick, which is 15, 0, 5 and 6. And like when we start from main, n will return the size of the array, in this case 4. Quick sort, we'll apply the quick sort exactly how we applied merge sort, which is from 0 to 3, which is the last index of our array. Once it gets called, it will be called from 0 to 3. Since low is less than high, we are going to call our partition function, which takes in our array, which is this one, along with, anybody has a question? Okay. Along with the low and high values as 0 and 3, which is in this case 0, 1, 2, and 3. Okay. So we call this. Now here we actually choose a pivot, which is in this case, the pivot is always the first element of our array. Okay. That's what we are selecting, which is in this case, it's going to select the pivot as 15. And what it's going to do is it's going to use the same pseudocode which I showed you earlier, which is we are going to use this terminology of up and down. We keep moving the up till we found an element that is greater than the pivot, and we keep moving down towards the left side till the element is smaller than the pivot, and so on. So which is we have up equal to 0 and down equal to 3 in this case. And then what we do is we apply the same pseudocode, which is till the time up is less than down. What we do is we have our first loop that runs from up, which is in this case up is 0. And it's going to run till high, which is 3. And at every iteration, it is checking if the array at up, which is this value of up, which is 15, is greater than pivot, which is, since that's not the case, it will keep moving. Okay, so I think it will go further till the end of the array, and it will be like right here at the end of this. Okay, which is since all the elements, it will never be actually greater than the pivot, because there are no other elements that are greater than the pivot. So this entire loop will execute, and at the end of our iteration of this entire loop, R up would roughly be here, which is the last location, the location that is next to the last location in the array. Okay. Now talking about the second loop, what it's going to do is it's going to start from high, which is actually pointing here, and it is going backward, which is it's going till we reach low, and we are decrementing because we are going backward. And what we check is, whenever we found the first element which is lower than the pivot, which is this itself is the first element that is lower than the pivot, the first element here, which is for this line, then we actually break. So we essentially go to these lines. Okay. So essentially what we have is low is also pointing to, down is also pointing to the last element in this case. And then what we do is, since up is less than down, that's false. So we'll go right here, and it will swap these elements at low and down, which is essentially 6 and 15 are going to be swapped, which is 6 will go here and 15 will go here. And then we return down, which is it's going to return this value, which is 15 is going to get returned back to this calling function. What that is, The down is essentially the index that is pointing to this 15, which is in this case 3. So what we essentially have is we now have a pivot element that is number 3, and all the elements towards the left of the pivot are lesser, and all elements towards the right of the pivot are greater. This is how the algorithm is behaving. And then we call the same quick sort on the first half, which is from the low to pivot minus 1, which is we call quick sort on this half, and we call quick sort on the other half. But pivot plus 1 is essentially like 4 and high is 3, because we had high equal to 3. So this part will never get executed in the recursive calls, because low is not less than high. But for the other part, which is this recursive call, it will still call, like it will still behave exactly how it did for the other recursive call, which we just saw. Okay. So next time what will happen is it will call like quick sort on this half, and then it will call the partition function. Again, you choose the pivot as the first element, which is, in this case, it's going to be 6. And you go through all these loops. It will arrange the elements in such a way that all the elements towards the left of 6 will be lesser, and all the elements towards the right of 6 will be greater, which is, in this case, I think 6 will be moved here, and all the elements like 0 and 6 will be swapped. Like, you can visualize this in one of the tools. I'm not going into a depth again, because I explained you how the recursion is working, okay? Questions? Okay. So the last thing we need to discuss is-
I have a question.
Yes.
Did you go back?
Yeah.
So why are you, in the main, why are you dividing the size of the data by the size of the array over the size of the first value?
This is just a mechanism in C++ to find the size of an array.
Oh, okay. Okay, that makes sense.
You use just like a collection, which is you use the standard array, then you just can call like dot size. But essentially what this does is size of the data will return the entire chunk of memory, which is like defined for this array, and size of data of 0 will give you the size occupied by one element. If you divide the two, you'll get like 4. That's how it is, those calculations, if anybody is interested, okay? You can use a standard collection or a vector, then you don't have to like calculate it, okay? Any other questions? Okay. So I was explaining you the time complexity. So in the worst case, quicksort behaves like an O(n) square, which is, it's quadratic in nature, while in the average or best case, it's like n log n, okay? And the space complexity is log n, which is, it takes like total log n recursions on the call stack, okay? Sorry. Okay, so I think with that, let's move to sets, maps, and hash tables. Who will tell me what's a set in like maths or stats? Yep. So, like, if it is n log n and two n log n, because of the big O notation, I think it will not make a difference if we are talking about a large data set, if that makes sense. Does that make sense? Yeah, so we'll not, like, we don't care which algorithm we actually use in that case, okay? Yeah, any other questions? I think somebody was mentioning what is a set data structure. Anybody would like to try that? Or just like a regular set in stats? Mm-hmm. Okay, that makes sense. That's a great answer. I think that's also the correct answer. So we are already done with all the linear and nonlinear ordered data structures. And now we are going to actually learn more about the not ordered ones, which is they do not have an inherent order underlying in that data structure itself. So when we talk about sets, a set is essentially a collection that contains like no duplicate elements. So these are 4 properties of set objects, which is they are, first of all, they are not indexed. The second one is they do not reveal the order of insertion of items, which essentially means, like, let's say if we have this collection of different fruits, if we have apple and let's say a strawberry in this collection, we do not know whether apple was inserted first or whether strawberry was inserted first. We don't care about that. That's the second property. The first property is it's not indexed, which is you cannot do something like if you have a set S, you cannot do set of I, which is exactly same as how stacks and queues behaved, okay? The third thing is they do not enable, they do enable efficient search and retrieval of information, which is you can quickly tell whether an apple exists in this collection or not. That's another property. And the fourth property is they allow removal without moving elements around, which is if we have pineapple in this and we want to remove pineapple from this set, other elements will not know whether pineapple was moved out of the set. Okay, that's the fourth property. So essentially the set ADT, when we talk about the set ADT, specifically the abstract data type, it consists of different operations, which is a few operations are listed here, which is find. And what find does is it tells us whether an item exists in our set, which is like, if you have a set of objects, if I want to find out whether apple exists in that set, I'll use the find operation. Adding an element means just an insert operation, and removing an element means a remove operation, which is you just remove an item from the set. There are a few other operations that are maintained by a set ADT, which is union, intersection, and difference. Anybody would like to tell me what's a union of two sets? Yes. Yes, so exactly, which is you add two sets, but it does not have duplicates. We are just going to see some visuals. Intersection means what are the common elements in the two sets, and difference means what are the elements in set A but not in B. And the final set of operations that we see is a subset operation, which essentially checks whether an element in a set or an entire set is a subset of another set. So here are some visuals of these operations. Like, let's say if you have two sets, one is called A and this other one is called set B, okay? If I take the union of these two sets, which is A union B, would give me a new set that has all elements of A and all elements of B, and it will not have duplicates because that is a property of the sets. When I talk about the intersection of sets A and B, it will actually give me back what are the common elements in A and B, which is essentially this is more like an OR operation, while this is more like an AND operation. So here you can see like lemon is the only fruit that is common in both the sets. So an intersection operation will yield just a new set that contains lemon. So let's talk about the other two operations, which is like, there's another operation called difference, which essentially returns what are the elements that are in A, like if this is set A, but are not in B, okay? So in this case, lemon is subtracted from these two. Strawberry and grape would be our answer because they are not in set B, okay? If this is B minus A, you would actually do like this minus this, which will actually yield just an apple, okay? Subset. So set A is a subset of B, like it's defined as a subset of B if every element of set A is also an element of set B, which is in this case, you can see lemon is in this set, strawberry is in this set, grapes are in this set. So this entire set is a subset of the other set. But let's say if it had another fruit, like let's say a kiwi or something like that, this is not going to be a subset, and we denote it using this notation, which is like set A is not a subset of set B, okay? This is the notation that we use for like subsets. While for union, we use this notation, and for intersection, we use this notation, okay? Okay, so this is just like a background refresher of your high school classes. Now let's discuss what is the core differences between list and sets, and then we'll go into C++ and identify how these are constructed, which is lists actually have order among the elements, which is Like, let's say if we insert an element, it would be inserted at a particular index. But in set, there's no concept of an order. Duplicates or lists may contain duplicates, while sets will never contain duplicates. When we talk about the implementation, lists can be implemented using array-based notation or like linked list, as we earlier saw. While when we talk about sets, they might be backed by an array or by a tree, okay? So when we see the implementations, like this will get really clear. So let's talk about the first thing, which is sets in C++, okay? So when we talk about sets in C++, there are two kinds of sets. One is called an ordered set, which is also just called like a set. And the other one is called an unordered set, okay? Which is, it does not have an inherent ordering of items, while the ordered set actually is, the elements are ordered in some way. Like you'll understand what I'm trying to say once we like see the implementations. When we talk about the initialization, like if we are talking about STL specifically, you define a set like this, which is std set, and then the template argument, which is going to be your type of data, and then unordered set is defined like this, okay? The common methods in a ordered set include like insert, erase, find, count, size, empty. Insert essentially inserts an element into a set. So if I do something like s.insert, and this is a set of integers, and I do 10, it will just insert a value into the set. Erase deletes this number 10. Find finds whether a number 10 exists in the set or any particular number. Count returns the count of an element in the set. What could be the value of a count in this case? Anybody would like to try? Zero. What else? Anybody else? Yes. One. Okay. What else? Five. Okay. Can it have any arbitrary values? Actually, no, because it can only have like zero or one, because it does not have duplicates. So it will never have like a value like 500 or something like that. Okay. Even though we insert 10 like twice, it will just override the existing value of 10 every time you insert 10, okay? Because intrinsically, sets cannot contain duplicates, okay? Talking about the implementation of an ordered set, okay, I did not cover the methods of the other one, which is for an unordered set, the methods in C++ standard library include insert, erase, find, count, size, empty, which is exactly the same as the previous ones. But it also has two other like methods, which is bucket size and load factor. I think they are not methods, probably bucket size. They are methods. They are kind of, what do you call, like getters and setters. There's another terminology. I'm just forgetting what is the other terminology for getters and setters? Accessors and mutators, great, yeah. So they are kind of like accessors and mutators for variables that are initialized in that set. We are going to see like what they are, and you are going to actually implement all of these in your project too, okay? So tree-based sets are essentially like implemented using any form of tree, which is we already know different data structures we have studied before. Like if we used an array or a linked list to implement something like this, you will get an O1 insertion or an O(n) deletion or vice versa, which is if we insert elements into an array in O(n), we can delete it in O1. So we already saw that trade-off in heaps, so I'm not going to cover it again. So what we are going to use to implement sets for an ordered set is a regular tree. You can use any tree, okay? For the project, you are using your AVL tree to use to actually imitate a set. In the standard library in C++, this is actually implemented behind the scenes in the form of a red black tree. Okay. I'm going to show you a demo on like, not a demo, but I'll just show you the libraries on actually it is a red black tree. Okay. So essentially, like, let's say if we have a tree object that you already created, you can just call like methods of that tree object to insert values into the set, which is like, let's say if I do insert 10, what it will do is in an empty tree, it will insert like 10 into this tree. If I call again, like insert with a value 15, it will insert 15 into the set. So essentially we are representing the set in the form of a BST or any form of balance tree that we already saw. And these methods, which is erase, find, count, you can easily apply, which is in the first project, what you did for erase, you actually implemented remove, which removes an element. When we talk about find, it is essentially calling your search method, like search by ID. Count is kind of similar, or size will return the size and so on. Okay. Any questions so far on ordered sets? Okay. So the time complexity of all these operations, if we actually use a tree-based set, is like log n, because the operations, like these operations were log n, right? And we are just calling those operations. Is there any time complexity that would not be log n? Yes. If it is not self-balancing? Yes, yes, that's right. So if we just used a BST, which is not a balanced BST, like not an AVL tree or something like that, then it would be ON in the worst case, right? Otherwise, it will be like log N. Now, talking about the unordered sets, these things actually use another data structure that is called a hash table, which we are going to cover on Thursday's class, which is we are going to invent the hash table from scratch so that you can know how internally it works. But is it clear to everybody, like for the project two, you are essentially using somebody else's AVL tree code and just calling the insert method of that code or the remove method of that code or the search method of that code. You don't have to do anything else, which is, it might just be some few function calls. In some cases, maybe the code base that you got assigned might not have the function parameters as you expect, which is you might be expecting it might return a Boolean, but it's returning an integer. In that case, you just need to correct those things. And it's totally fine if you want to change those signatures, okay? So let's take a quick example. Like this is sets in C++. And this is an example of both ordered set and a unordered set, okay? So when we talk about an ordered set, you define an ordered set using this notation, which is set integers S1. Like I'm naming it as S1, you can name it anything. And when I insert these values, which is 5, 2, 4, 11, 2, this set will essentially, behind the scenes, since this is an ordered set, it will just create a tree, which is 5 will be inserted, 2 will be inserted on the left, 4 on the right, and then there'll be rotations based on whatever tree you have. 11 will be inserted here, and 2 will be overridden, like since the set cannot contain duplicates, okay? So here, when you actually iterate over the set, you can use an iterator, which is all the collections have iterator classes that are implemented for you. So this is how you define an iterator, because you cannot do something like this, which is S of I, if you know the size of the set, like this will give you an error. So you start the iterator from s1.begin, and you keep on iterating till s1.end, and this thing actually prints the values, which is, you can see it prints these values in 2, 4, 5, 11. So which type of traversal is it calling behind the scenes? Sorry? In order traversal, that's absolutely right. Yes. So for the first part, which is the tree-based set, you don't have to implement the iterator. For this one, you have to actually implement the iterator, okay? We'll talk more about how to build an iterator on Thursday, okay? For this one, actually, you are not required to build an iterator, okay? So the unordered set, like if you insert these values, what you can see is like you define an unordered set using this convention. And then like if I try to print the unordered set using just the same terminology, which is I have an unordered set iterator, I've defined that, and I'm going over the iterator. If I'm printing the values, you can see like although I inserted the values as 5, 2, 4, 11, and 2, the set is giving some random values. Like how that behaves, how those algorithms behave, you'll not understand it right now, but after Thursday you'll understand it because we'll see all the components of that set, okay? Now there were some other attributes, which is there's something called bucket count, load factor, and max load factor. You'll know this terminology again on Thursday, but essentially what it does is behind the scenes, bucket count, let me just erase this. So bucket count, what it does is it initially, like I told you, unordered sets are backed by arrays. So internally, what it does is when it's adding these items, it creates an arbitrary array, which is in this case, it's creating an array of size 7 for some reason, okay? And load factor essentially is the total number of elements divided by the total number of buckets. So this set has 4 elements. So if you divide 4 by 7, which is the total size of the bucket, this is going to give you the same number, which is 0.57, okay? That's what's internally going on. And max load factor determines what is the maximum load factor that is preset, okay? What are these terms? Again, on Thursday, it will get really, really clear, okay? So what I'll do really quickly is I'll just show you in C++ that these things are actually defined, like I'm not trying to lie that they are like red, black trees and stuff. You can just go and check in the library. So I'll just give you a quick tour of that. So let me share my screen. Okay. Can you guys see my screen? Let me change. Okay, that's enough. Maybe I should do it for the last one as well. Okay. Let me stop sharing this. Okay, so most of you might be using like Windows. I think a majority of you use Windows. So I'll just give you a glimpse into how these are defined in the library, which is what you have to do is you might have downloaded like MinGW, which comes packaged with MSys64, which is the instructions that were given to you to install like C++. So essentially, like let's say if we are talking about the STL set, what we can do is we can try to find out the path by just using like searching for, I think STL set should be a good search. Okay, so there is a file. I'm going to show you how it is implemented in the library itself, which is what I'm going to do is I'm just going to copy this path. Okay, sorry about that. Which is actually this is in your C drive. If you go to your MSys64 or wherever you have installed this, yes. Okay, what happened? Weird. It's weird. Just give me a second. You're having some technical difficulties. Oh, it's the laptop. Okay, now I found it. There you go. Okay, can you see this now? Good. Okay, that's good. So what I was trying to say was like wherever you downloaded the, wherever your system installed the C++, I'm not sure like where it installs by default in Mac because I'm not a Mac user, but I think if you do just grep and try to find out the files, you should be able to do that if you just do grep stl underscore set or stl underscore map. So what I was trying to say was, I think for me, it actually downloaded it inside like MinGW64. If you go to include folder, C++, and then you actually can see all the C++ stl installed under this folder called bits, which actually you can see the code for all the different libraries. So essentially what I'm going to do is I'm just going to open like VS Code, and I just wanted to show you that like if I open the internal libraries, these sets, how they are actually implemented is using okay, there you go. So essentially, like you can see all the different STL containers here, which is like you have already used vectors, lists, what else we have done, like different forms of trees and stuff. They are already implemented behind the scenes in the library. And a good way to learn about these structures, if you want to see like how industry level code is written or how professional code is written, you can go into these libraries and check out how they have implemented, like let's say an array, or how they have implemented the set data structure, because you are trying to mimic that, okay? So let's talk about set. Like you can see, like if you go to the set class, which is, this is the header file for the STL set. If you scroll this further, I think it has a lot of templated code because we are not using templates, but let's say if you try to like analyze some of this might be a little bit cryptic for you because I think quite a lot of you are not CS majors, so we don't go into internals of each of those functions because a majority of you will not be using like library specific things. We are just dealing with abstractions. So you are not supposed to memorize any of this, but I'm just giving you an idea that internally, this is an ordered set. So if you just search the type of tree here in this file, you can see it is actually using like a red black tree behind the scenes, okay? And if I just go to the definition of this, you can actually see that this is defined in another class, that in another header file that's called stl underscore tree. And if you scroll through this class, you can find out like they are exactly doing all the rotations that you were doing. Like it's a little bit complex in how they have named all the variables because they are following a particular standard. But essentially, if you go to the insert function, you can see all the rotations. They are working with like red color or so on. Like, let's say if I just search red here, you can see like they have this like red color for every node. And they like these are the if cases. Like when we had the balancing, if you remember in AVL tree, you balance these different nodes. In red black tree, if you remember, we were checking if the uncle is red or not. So that's what they are doing right here, checking if it is like what kind of rotation needs to be called. But this is like a handy tool. If you want to understand anything that is like not on the internet maybe or something like that, you can just go into the different like libraries and check it out how they have implemented it, okay? Any questions on this? Okay, let's go back. Okay. What happened to this? Just a second. There you go. So just stop sharing this. Let me share this back. Okay. So with that, let's start with the other data structure. That is like maps. It is pretty similar to sets. If you understand sets, you understand basically maps as well. There's just one other thing, which is like map is essentially like key value pairs, set is essentially keys, okay? So a map is a collection of key value pairs that do not contain duplicate keys, which essentially means that keys here are essentially a set itself, okay? Because they cannot be duplicates. And they have a value set, which is each key is paired with a particular value, which is like, let's say if we insert a key value pair, like 1, apple, this 1 is like a key and this value is apple. And you could have any data type as a key and any data type as a value, okay? So they are kind of abstractions over sets, and the keys in a map are essentially set, which I just told you. The values can be non-unique, which is like, what I mean by that is, let's say if we insert 1, we can also insert like 2, that's totally fine. Which is, these values can be duplicates of each other, but the keys can never be duplicates. And if you store values along with keys in a data structure, you get a map. That's what essentially this states. So this is a map that contains these key value pairs, which is J is pointing to Jane, B is pointing to Bill, B2 is pointing to Bill, and then S is pointing to Sam, which is, these are keys and these are values. So this is a very handy data structure. You'll use this a lot, like in a lot of other algorithms, in your programming interviews and stuff, you will be asked a lot of questions on maps and sets because they are really, really fast and they allow you fast searches, okay, compared to all the other data structures we have seen. So these are some examples. Like, let's say if you are creating a database, you might be modeling, like, let's say a university. So in that case, a key here would be a student ID, which is like your UF ID, while the value would be all the other attributes, like you might be storing that in the form of an object. Or if we talk about like an online retail or e-commerce website, your email might be your primary key and all the other info might be your values. Similarly, if you are modeling maybe another problem where you are keeping track of your inventory in your workshop, the part ID or any particular value might be the primary key, which is kind of the key of the map, and all the description, the cost, price, where it is located, everything might be a value because it might be non-unique and so on, okay? So maps in C++ also are of two types. One is ordered and unordered, exactly same as sets. The ordered maps have order in the elements, while unordered maps do not. You initialize a map using this convention, which is now you have two types, one for your key and another for the value, and same for the unordered maps, okay? The common methods in maps in C++ include insert. This is an operator that is usually overloaded, which is, like, let's say if you define M, you can actually insert using this notation, which is M of apple is equal to 1, which is whatever is in this, this denotes your key and this, the right-hand side denotes the value. Okay, that's another way to do this, which is in an array, the index itself is like a key, okay? But here, this is also a common convention in other programming languages. Like, let's say if you use a dictionary in Python, in Java's, you might be using, what's the data structure in Java, anybody? Hashmap or hash table, hashmap. So if you call like a hashmap, you might be using something like this, which is M of this, which is, I think it's also called associative arrays. I remember in programming one, we teach this as associative arrays. The common methods, again, like, this is insert. This is another equivalent way of inserting. Erase deletes a particular key along with its value. Find finds a particular key. Count returns if 1 or 0. I don't know why they have this method because it does not make sense in like instantiation, because you can only have like either an element in the set or map, or it does not. So it's going to be 0 or 1. size returns how many elements are in the map, and empty returns if the map is empty or not. Internally, in C++, this is implemented as a red-black tree, while an unordered map is implemented as a hash table, which we are going to see on Thursday, okay? Like, if you want to know a different time complexity and different operations, like let's say if you are working with these, you can refer to this website. You can see, like, if you go to any particular function, like let's say if you go to the insert function here, I think it should say somewhere that this is implemented as a red-black tree, maybe in the complexity. Yeah. You can see the time complexities are n log n because these are like maps that are backed by, maybe there should be trees here. It was on the last page. There you go. Maps are typically implemented as BSTs, and I just showed you, like, they are actually internally, they are red-black trees. Going back, this is an example of a map data structure in action. We are going to see some problems as well on Thursday, which are going to use just the STL versions of maps and sets because they are like so important. We do cover them. So earlier we actually showed you, like in the previous example, I showed you iterators on like that are used to iterate over a set. Here I'm using the for each loop to iterate over a map. You can use that for a set as well because internally it actually is equivalent to calling iterators, which is what I did was I have a set here, which is called table. And this line actually creates an entry in the table that has key B value 30. Next, it creates A, N, C, 50. And when I do table of A, 40, it is going to override the existing value of A with 40 instead of 10. It's not going to create a new entry because it cannot contain duplicate keys. So next here, I print the entire map and I use this convention, which is you can use either, like you can define the entire thing with an iterator, which is going to look like this, which is std, unordered map. Sorry, this is a map. This is not an unordered one. And then you define like an iterator. Like you can use that or you can use the auto keyword. And member will give you an entry to like each of these rows, which is you're iterating over the table one at a time. Now, important thing to note is this is stored internally in the form of a pair. Anybody know what's a pair data structure in C++? So pair is another data structure in C++ specifically, which is essentially a collection of two items, which is like, you can define a pair like this, which is int, comma, int, or any type of pairs. And you can store in this pair, like maybe like values, like 1, 2, okay? So essentially this thing, what it returns is, like member is actually pointing to the row, which contains like a pair of B, 30. So to access the first element of the pair, you use this convention, which is member.first. And to access the second element, you use member.second, which is, this is the key which is stored at member.first, and this is the value that is stored at member.second, okay? So that's why, like, it has these values, A40, B30, and C50, and so on, okay? Yeah, and the unordered map, you use the same convention, but it also has some other methods, which we are going to discuss on Thursday when we invent this. So now I think you have all the knowledge to work on project 2A part A, which is working on the code base and converting that into an ordered map, okay? You don't have the knowledge for unordered map. We are going to finish that on Thursday and then you can do the complete project, okay? But I think these are standalone parts of the project. So if you want, you can start working on the first part, okay? Because you have all the details. Any questions? Yes. Okay, so the question is, since all the methods are same for an unordered and an ordered map, why do we have unordered maps? The reason is we are going to improve the efficiency, because what we saw right now for ordered map, all time complexities of different operations were log n. We are going to make those O1 on Thursday. Okay. So that's why like unordered map is the most powerful data structure and the most useful data structure that you like learn in this course. Okay. Have a wonderful evening, everybody. Take care. Oh, okay. Good. No problem.